Welcome. In this module, I'd like to talk about transformative learning for sustainability. In other modules, we already talked about the nature of wicked problems and that they require different forms of learning and public engagement than, say, conventional problems for which we can have a clear definition and kind of agree as to what we need to be doing and agree on what how we should go about doing that. With wicked problems like climate change, loss of biodiversity and food security, this is a different story altogether. We've already talked about simple versus complex versus wicked problems, and you can go to the module where we talk about that and the resources for that module if you want to understand that better still. But I think it is very important to understand that we have different forms of education and learning that can address wicked sustainability problems. Let me go back to a slide or a variation of a slide used also in the module on environmental education and ESD. If we look at those educations from a pedagogical or learning point of view, and you have, say, a narrow focus or view of that type of education, EE minus or ESD minus, you could say that the learning tends to be instruction oriented, more transmissive, where there are right answers that can be maybe reproduced or displayed on an exam or a test. But when we talk about dealing with wicked problems, that type of learning is not as useful as, say, more interactive forms of learning where we need to learn from each other, where we need to learn to use from diverse perspective, maybe even conflicting perspectives and values. And that type of learning will be more experiential, discovery-based, and you could call it transformative. Not just learning for knowing, but also learning for being, and learning to make change, and learning to transform. And that type of learning is critical for dealing with wicked issues. Here's some key elements of transformative learning for sustainability. You could say one is understanding change, complexity, and transitions. Two, utilizing diversity, creating synergy, seeing connections. Four, building agency and transformative capacity, empowerment. And fourth, considering ethics, values, empathy, and care. Let me quickly go through those. First, the complexity and change and transitions. You could say there are two perspectives on change. One is we need to optimize the current systems in which we live. Take as an example capitalism. You could say that capitalism or empirical analytical science has brought us many good things. The fact that I can speak to you in a room where I'm being taped, you could say as a result of that type of thinking, it has been very powerful, has brought lots of convenience and comfort to our lives. And we can just optimize it and green it. On the other hand, it might be that some of the issues that we're talking about today, the wicked problems that we're talking about today, might be the result of that very same system and the values and assumptions underneath that system. And if we want to really respond to global systemic dysfunction, we need to rethink those values and assumptions and maybe not so much do the things we do better, but do better things. We might call it a transition or a transition perspective. So, and we can look at it from a more technological perspective or a more societal perspective or from both. And if you do that and we look, for instance, at food, nutrition security, if you want to optimize, if you want to feed the world in 2050 with 9 billion people, we could say, well, we just optimize our current systems, minimizing food waste, for instance, improving food literacy so that people make better choices. Or a more technological approach might be better, a transition towards more a GMO-oriented society where we use less pesticides, less fossil fuels, and we are more efficient and productive, but it requires a real major shift in technology. Or you could say, no, we need to move maybe a transition to the way we think about food and the way we distribute wealth and equity, fair food justice, or maybe a mind shift or a cultural shift in what we eat. Maybe we should be eating insects as an alternative protein to eating meat. Maybe that's the solution. Or a combination of a transitionary perspective might be that we say we need to have a real a rethinking of our economy, a rethinking of how we integrate different functions, cradle to cradle, closed cycle design. For instance, in metropolitan agriculture, we could use vertical agriculture, use sun energy in a better way. So it can be also high tech, but it also can bring people together around food, create social cohesion in neighborhoods. So it's both. And if we do that, then we can feed not only the world in 2050, but we can also have meaningful and high quality lives. So that's another perspective. Now, many of these changes and transitions, they follow certain stages. And Gils and Schott have come up with this interesting way of looking at that, how niches, where there's a small incubator, some disruptive ideas, some counterintuitive idea maybe even, where people try new things and experiment in those niches. Look at guerrilla gardening, for instance, as ecological restoration in abandoned lands or dysfunctional areas, trying to revitalize that. That could lead to a coalescence between different initiatives. They could reinforce one another, and it could lead to a whole shift in regime. Look at school garden programs, community garden programs in cities, and that could lead maybe to a whole green or urban agriculture where it's not just about food anymore, it's about mobility, it's about energy, it's about water, and the whole nexus has changed and the whole landscape has shifted. And we could look and learn more about the kinds of factors that influence that type of learning. Second, utilizing diversity, creating synergy, seeing connections. This also has to do with systems thinking. Not just learning to think in terms of categories, boxes, disciplines, and trying to dissect the world, but trying to see the world whole, seeing the connections, seeing relationships, organizing events in a way that different perspectives will meet, different time perspectives, intergenerational perspectives, but also intercultural perspectives that allow people to think about consequences here and in the future, but also here and elsewhere. Seeing how, in this case, an example of a single tea bag, how it relates to economic, ecological, ethical, environmental aspects. So this is like the industrial cup of tea from the CTI here in Wageningen MSP guide. Building agency and transformative capacity, giving people the tools, the possibilities to measure, for instance, quality of their own health, their own environment, using maybe also ICT and smartphones, but also giving them an opportunity to experiment, to try things out, and to learn from trying things out, using citizen science or civic science. Engaging them in disruptive activities, which may be needed not just to adapt to the changing world, which we always hear a lot about, but also to disrupt the systems that caused this global systemic dysfunction in the first place. So that also has to do with change and transformation and being creative about drawing attention to important issues or being a little bit defiant in how we do things. This is a response to the ban on gathering groups of people in Paris at the COP21, and this is how people responded, by putting their shoes and having their shoes gather on the square. It's an act of disruption, but a very generative one. Considering ethics, values, empathy, and care, that's another, the final dimension, that helps, I think, in rethinking the direction of our lives. Also bearing in mind what are the consequences of what we do for the lives of maybe people living elsewhere, people mining the metals that we use in our cell phones, or when we eat food, or when we wear clothes, under what conditions were they made, in what kinds of circumstances, and how are the people affected by that, and how can it be done in a fair or more equitable way, but also looking at how ethics and values can enter schools and classrooms in a way that allows people to see that the values that we tend to emphasize and strengthen in our current education system tend to be beneficial for mainly economic interest. Schools are becoming an extension of the global economy, and they're not focusing much on arts, humanities, connecting with place, or developing values like solidarity, empathy, or spirituality for that matter, or thinking about other species and recognizing that we are only one species on this planet. So that has to do with values and place and connecting also with other species and developing this kind of social cohesion around working on sustainability issues. This is a neighborhood in the Netherlands that tries to be sustainable in many different ways, too many to discuss in just a few minutes. Generally, dealing with wicked problems and having transformative processes and transitions require connecting what we call the big five, connecting the world of business, the world of education, the world of research, the world of the civic society, governance, and NGOs, societal activist organizations. How to connect these in a meaningful way, how to facilitate that type of learning, brokering relationships, that becomes the focus of people working on education in this kind of a context. If you look at schools, whole school approaches, this is what a school might be looking like then. Walking the talk, having energy neutral or CO2 neutral schools, having alternative energy, but also having healthy foods in the school canteens, connecting with the place around the school, maybe growing your own vegetables as a school, having a bicycle repair shop or a phone repair shop, a little bit of entrepreneurship, connecting with organizations and groups outside of the school, small businesses, healthcare centers, the government, and co-creating a school that breathes sustainability.